I just want to thank you all for joining us. I think everybody's here and ready to go. I recognize a lot of faces and names out there. We're delighted that you can be here with us this morning. Today, we're sharing our consumer trends report for 2022 called Rebound and Rebalance. I'm Fritz Fridlin. I'm a research director here in Sydney. I'm welcomed here with Heidi Turner, who is our research director up in Brisbane. And we're joined today by Yuri and Lily, our global trends experts. Katia from Content Marketing is also joining us. So thank you all for being here. It is an international crowd today. We have a lot to share today. So my apologies, we're not going to have time for questions, but feel free to email any of us with anything directly, or there's an email address up there at the top. We'll also show that at the end in case you miss it here. So let's get started. Okay, so what are we talking about today? We're going to share some information we have from our annual global trends research. We will also be reviewing the Australian data. So, you know, if you represent a multinational, you'll be able to see how the trends play out in different markets. Now, with culture and trends reports, I often see experts cherry picking data, you know, to tell the story that they want to tell. But at Insights, what I really like is that we use a really robust mix of qual and quant to tease out those trends. So what we're going to share with you today, while it's punchy and pithy, I would say is backed by some really robust global data. Katia will get into that in a little bit more detail in a moment. As you listen this morning, I encourage you to consider how a given trend is manifesting in your category or business, or how it might in the near future. And with that, allow me to hand you over to Katia to give you a bit of background on the research.
Yes, thank you, Fritz, for the great introduction, and welcome everyone also from my end here today. So just like last year, we bundled what we found are the key consumer trends for the year to come. And just like Fritz mentioned, this year's report is themed Rebound and Rebalance, because 2021 was the year of collective readjustment. If you look back, going back to the first year of the pandemic, you could say that we were all in this sort of waiting game for the new normal, or the going back to normal, whichever you want to call it. However, the enduring pandemic reality, the ongoing natural disasters and acts of injustices, people came to realize that uncertainty is a given. And you could say we started reclaiming our lives. And for some, this meant pivoting things on a personal or on professional level. And like never before, people moved houses and moved places, but also moved jobs. And you might have seen it all over the media. The 2021 is also labeled as the Great Resignation, with between April 21 and September 21, more than 24 million people in US alone quitting their jobs. And the same trend is also visible across the globe, and also in Australia, where you could say that there's the pandemic burnout, which makes people really quit their jobs as a way to cope with this uncertainty as a given. So on one hand, we see people making these life-changing decisions, while on the other hand, we see also people coping with this uncertainty by making small tweaks, focusing on small rituals as a way to regain balance. So you could say that 2021 was the year where we tried to find a new balance between, on one hand, the short term, which is about focusing on the now, really enjoying these small moments of joy, and on the other hand, the long term, where we still as people have this need to plan ahead and plan for the future. So it's really about this duality, balancing off purpose, so the long term and pleasure, the short term, that we try to seek to fulfill in order to achieve happiness. So it's about finding that equilibrium through rebound and rebalance. And happiness is, in fact, also at the forefront of our culture and trends human drivers model, which we use also as a framework in our culture and trends work. Positive psychology shows us that there's seven human drivers, universal drivers, that people seek to fulfill in order to achieve happiness and well-being, which is, in the end, the ultimate goal in life. And while their goal remains unchanged, the way they're manifested in our behavior is in fact influenced by the world around us. Also going forward, you will see, looking at the trends that we present you today, but also if you have a browser or look at the report, you will see these color codes also coming back, showcasing what are the drivers underneath each of these trends. If we look at last year's report, there we saw that relationship, health, and security, you could say we're at the forefront of our minds battling through the pandemic. So key drivers there. However, entering 2022, we see that achievement, which links to that purpose that I mentioned, and positive emotion, pleasure, are actually key drivers as we are re-evaluating how we spend our time and energy in a world where uncertainty is the only given. Now, we used, of course, this framework is the backbone of our culture and trends work. But if you look at a methodology point of view, what did we do to build this report? We started off with a qualitative exploration with our network of leading edge consumers. And this led to the identification of 10 consumer trends for 2022. Now, looking back at the trend report of last year, you could say that some of these trends are evolutions of last year's trends, while others are completely new in the space. However, as researchers, we not only want to understand which trends are manifesting around the globe, but also how this happens. And this is why we quantified these trends with in collaboration with our field partner Dynata, with more than 15,000 consumers in 17 markets. And this allows us to score each of these trends on consumer attitude and their behavior, and allows us to also plot these trends on those two parameters. Attitude, in fact, reflects the extent that people identify with a trend, whereas behavior, the extent that people act upon the trend. And doing so, of course, you get four quadrants, each representing a different attitudinal and behavioral adoption. And also plotting the trends, you can also, it allows you to see where the trend is in its life stage. Now, bottom left, what we have when you look at the 10 trends, we'll also go into depth into them in just a minute, but bottom left, we have what we label as nascent trends. These are trends with a low behavioral and attitudinal adoption. You could say that these trends are more leading edge way of thinking. So if you want to do something completely new or stand out in your category, this is a great place to start. Bottom right, we have what we label as emerging trends. These are trends with high attitude but low behavioral adoption, which means that people engage with the idea but don't act upon it. So here as a brand, you can lead the way and help, you could say, convert these views into actions. Here we find a trend which we label as actions for impact, which showcases that brands can really lead by example by taking a stand on societal issues. Top right, we have expanding trends. These are the trends that are really gaining momentum. And here we can find considered rituals, which links back to what I mentioned before about people seeking to find balance through small rituals in their lives. And then top left, we have establishing trends. These are trends that have become a normal part of life. Here we find a trend linked to sustainability, extending life, which is quite logical because extending sustainability is a concept that has been accepted throughout society, and people still feel the need to act upon it. Now, because of time reasons, today we cannot focus on all 10 trends. However, if you look at the mapping here, this is the mapping for Australia. Today we will highlight 5 trends which we feel are most interesting to highlight here today, also looking at the Australia data. Of course, we welcome you to have a look at the full report where each of these trends are highlighted, which we'll also send as a follow-up. Now, looking at the 5 trends that we'll highlight today, in the nascent space will tap into a sensory stimulation and inclusive connectivity. And on the expanding side, if you can click on the next slide, you will also see that we'll look at nonlinear lifestyles and considered rituals, which are Also very interesting trends, but also extending life, because if you recall, from a global perspective, that was on the establishing side. However, if you look at Australia, it's still in the expanding space, really meaning that it's gaining momentum. And I will give the word to Yuri, who will tell you all about extending life as a trend.
Thanks so much, Katja, for this explanation. So the first trend, as Katja mentioned, is called extending life, and it's linked to two drivers, two human drivers, the engagement driver and also the looking for more meaning driver. Rising environmental concerns around mass consumption and the growing eco-anxiety are driving the demand for more durable, long-lasting products. Preferring quality over quantity is a clear result of the global interpandemic self-reflections, with consumers now taking pride in extending the life of products they're using rather than replacing them. As you can see on the global mapping, this trend is rapidly going mainstream in most markets, except for the Chinese region, where it is still nascent. As this trend is all about circularity, using secondhand, recycled, recyclable products, but also about durability, using first life products for a longer time, it's no surprise to see consumer electronics, fashion, and home improvement indicated here as sector playing fields. Let's have a look at some examples. IKEA Norway did this daring campaign showing discarded IKEA products dumped on the streets and in junkyards to raise the awareness about 3 million pieces of furniture that are thrown away in Norway each year. And of course, also to show that its products are worth repairing as they keep their value, which is displayed by the reference prices you can see in the ad. On the campaign website, visitors can learn more about IKEA's buyback schemes, get price quotes for specific pieces, but also order spare parts when they want to repair them. In fashion, UK designer Stella McCartney made a lingerie and swimwear hybrid collection to make people buy less items and wear the same pieces more often, either as underwear or for swimming or yoga classes. Meanwhile, Petit Plis is experimenting with clothing that grows with the wearer. Founder Ryan Mario Yassin, an aeronautical engineer, is using the fabric's pleated nature to adapt to changing body shapes, making the same item useful for children between 6 and 36 months, who would normally cover 6 different clothing sizes. Inspired by re-commerce sites or resale sites like Depop and Vinted, H&M is piloting rewear in Canada, making it easy to buy and sell used fashion items, not only from H&M, as you can see on this visual, but from any brands, even from competitors. The algorithm recommends a competitive price, and H&M is just taking a 15% commission on all the sales. In an interview with Vogue, Pierre-Alexis Dumas, the artistic director of Hermès and great-great-great-grandson of Thierry Hermès, referred to his grandfather, who was defining luxury already back in the 60s as that which you can repair, stressing the fact that new luxury has sustainability at the core heart of it. This is an example from New Zealand, Sheep Included. I'm wearing one of their sweaters. They should sponsor me, by the way. They're creating these fine carbon negative merino wool sweaters, and they offer a generational guarantee for lifetime mending or repairing or maintenance whenever it's needed. But real infinite life cycles for thousands and thousands of years can be offered by NFTs or other pure digital goodies. Gucci Garden on gaming platform Roblox sold this Queen Bee Dionysus handbag, which would cost you $3,400 in a physical Gucci store for only $5.50 on Roblox. And although you can only show it off virtually in Roblox, it turned out to be a very good investment, as some girl was able to resell it for $4,115, widely surpassing the price of the physical handbag in the Gucci store. Beyond fashion and pressured by the right to repair movement, Apple announced self-service repair, finally allowing consumers access to Apple parts and tools. And meanwhile, consumer electronics company Framework is releasing this modular laptop you can see to the left of the slide that gives you full access to the hardware system, permitting you to fix it and upgrade it in whenever you desire it or whatever form you desire it. And then in beauty, the Danish eco startup Last Objects creates reusable alternatives for normally single-use hygiene and beauty products. They started in 2018. They're funded via Kickstarter, and they firstly introduced an eco-friendly alternative to the disposable cotton swabs, of which there are currently produced 1.5 billion a day, and they get often flushed in toilets and end up in the sea as the filtration systems are not catching them. In the meantime, the brand also developed Last Tissue, tissue that you can wash up to 520 times, and Last Round that you can see here, the home compostable zero-waste facial pads. Now we go to Heidi, and Heidi, I believe you will zoom in on the Australian results for this trend.
Yeah, sure. Hi, everybody. Welcome, everyone in Australia. So if we look at what's going on with Australia, not surprisingly, what we see is that these global trends and figures are very much in line with what we're seeing here. And not surprisingly, when we look at next-gen consumers particularly, we see that this trend is very prevalent. But I think the point to make is that it's not only younger consumers that extending life is important to. So with the trend being an expanding one, what's really important to notice is that it's becoming more mainstream. So it means that it's becoming an expectation that brands are now going to focus on giving back in creative ways. So it's no longer this kind of nice to do, or maybe we should do it. It's becoming an absolute necessity, and consumers are going to expect brands to play to this trend. So not surprisingly, what we can see is that it's impacting fashion, home improvement, and electronics. But most important to note really is that it's not just these sectors that consumers have these expectations. It extends to things like finance and travel as well. So moving on to an example, and you would have seen plenty of examples in Australia because of the mainstream nature of this, but a really good example is a new limited edition spirit, which was launched by Archie Rose. And basically it's made from 50 tons of smoke tainted Shiraz and Merlot grapes. So it's a wine washed spirit, which was made with Hunter Valley wineries when we had those awful bushfires. And so instead of letting the grapes go to waste, they then upcycled them. The next example is Closed Loop, which is an awesome company which is leading the way in building upcycled roads, curbs, benches, bumpers, speed control bumps, anything, you name it really, and all from recycled plastics. And what's really exciting about this is they've found a way to use our much loved coffee cups that we've always had a problem with when recycling. And some of you may have heard about Adidas and Parley's Save the Ocean initiative, and they built this floating tennis court during the Australian Open in the Barrier Reef, and they made it out of using upcycled plastic, so similar to the apparel that was worn by some of the players in the game. And then also once this is done, they're again going to upcycle and use that material in schools. Recycle Smart is another example, which is really revolutionizing the ease with which people recycle. So we know that people want to recycle, but very often the effort stops them and acts as a barrier. So this is a bit like Uber for recycling, where through their app, you simply just order recycling you need, and you leave your bags outside your door, and there you have it. Another example where it's making it easy for consumers to recycle is Flora and Fauna, where you can simply pop your old beauty products, hosiery, phone cases, etc., into the box that it came in, send it back to them free of charge, and then they also offer free store credit in exchange. Apparel in Melbourne is recycling old clothes and upcycling them into new ones, and then again they provide store credit for any donated clothing, etc., and they recycle these, and they're even making furniture out of 100% recyclable textiles. And I'll now hand over to Lily.
Great, thank you very much, Heidi, and good morning, everyone. It's your morning, not mine. I'm over in the UK, so we're on different kind of time zones at the moment, but great to see you all today. So while, as Heidi and Yori showed you, people are carefully extending the life of the products that they're using, conversely, what we're seeing is people ripping up the rule book when it comes to their own life stages. And that brings us to our next trend, non-linear lifestyles. So for a long time in culture and in many markets around the world, concepts like college education, marriage, having kids, buying a house, and retirement have been very clear markers of a life well lived. And as brands, we reflect this in the aspirations that we set out in our marketing. But what's really fascinating now is that we're seeing a real pushback on this. So whether it's, you know, a major midlife career change, adopting a nomad lifestyle, or elders moving into city centers, age norms are becoming less of a factor when it comes to the lifestyle choices that we make. And this is really opening up a whole new world of possibilities for people in terms of their relationships and also to their achievements, their goals, you know, which are ultimately the underlying human drivers that sit behind this trend. So if this is happening, why is this happening now? Well, the pandemic has really made people stop and think about their life situation today and what they want from their futures. And it has also accelerated existing shifts that were at play. So things like flexible work life opportunities and elder tech adoption. So for brands, this really represents a major creative opportunity to tell fresh stories about those kind of dynamic human passion points that are coming through from our consumers. So when we look at the global data, we can see the trend is expanding, notably in Europe and in Australia as well. And Fritz will deep dive a little bit more into that local perspective for you. But globally, we can see an interesting pattern in that kind of there's less engagement with this trend currently in some of the more Eastern markets like China and Korea, the Philippines. And this can be attributed to the kind of cultural and societal differences that we see around the need to have kind of more fixed life stage markers around careers and family lives in those markets. So that's from a market perspective. But when we look at it from a demographic point of view as well, we can see that this trend is equally relevant across all age groups, indicating its kind of cross-generational relevance. And then from a sector perspective, it's no surprise to see that a trend around kind of lifestyle expression, the most kind of dominant trend currently is fashion, because that's all about kind of our identity creation, how we express where we're at. But we also see kind of financial services and consumer electronics as being key here. And I will give you an example of that shortly. But it is important to say that the lesser served sectors currently also hold opportunities to do something new and different, for example, in retail. So to think about that, let's head over to a mixed living and community retail project in a market with the oldest population in the world, Japan. So Share Kanazawa is a project that centers on the premise that most of us, or all of us, aspire to live out our older lives with more joy and purpose. And the fact that they believe as a project that most of the kind of care homes and elder living facilities that we have around the world today are not fit for serving that, that human need. And at Share Kanazawa, which is just outside of Tokyo, elders can volunteer, they can mentor youths and young people with disabilities, they can collaborate with university students, and they can also work with small business operators who are also working and living on site. So it's a really kind of exciting kind of mixed community that operates there. And what's interesting is that, yes, it's subsidized by the government, but ultimately it's a commercial venture where everybody who is living there is contributing to the success of its running. And Japan is leading in kind of leading around the world in terms of these kind of projects, but we do see them kind of popping up everywhere. So I think a really interesting one that we can take a lot of learnings from. For example, you know, what are the opportunities to think about the role of elders in our society and in a kind of aging population in categories like retail, care and service delivery? And also as brands, how can we think about kind of co-creating fit for purpose solutions for different demographics in a way that doesn't play to kind of traditional or outdated cultural norms around age? And it's not just on the elder end of the kind of life stage where we see a cultural shakeup happening around lifestyles. So financial investments is a category that is traditionally associated with more serious, kind of maybe city center, middle-aged cultural norms. But this has been really entirely disrupted in the last few years by the cryptocurrency movement, and as also with innovations in gaming and in digital experience at large. And a great example of this is Axie Infinity, a Philippines-based play-to-earn NFT game where users earn tokens that can be exchanged for real currency. And in this game, you have ideas like building up a collection or kind of battling others, and obviously all very gamified. And this really shifts the focus away from, you know, stocks and shares and kind of more traditional ideas to financial play and exploration. So if we think about where this is heading as a trend and in the future and the implications for brands, things like the metaverse is going to take this, you know, to the next level. And it's important that brands in financial services or any brands that kind of operate in the money space kind of get creative with how they're presenting their services and their products, because ultimately the standard model around, you know, a college saving account or a retirement fund is no longer going to be relevant in the future. So that's the global perspective. What's happening in Australia? Fritz, tell us more.
Thanks, Lily. So generational theory suggests that we're undergoing a moment of crisis in society right now, where consensus is low, society is breaking apart, we're seeing deviance and a bit of lawlessness around the world. And of course, COVID is exacerbating that sort of global social pressure cooker. But perhaps the positive flip side of the coin is that nonlinear lifestyle trend, which is also driven by deviance, but which manifests in societal new norms around how people live their lives. And this trend is a part of the racial, gender, and identity movements we're seeing. People are re-examining their lives and how they spend their time, which is why lately we've been seeing things like geriatric drummers on YouTube and older people using CBD alongside 15-year-old entrepreneurs and young, you know, environmental activists. So an interesting Australian organization called Verto highlights this nonlinearity in the modern career cycles, and they help keep people active in the job force by supporting them through training and apprenticeships and employment assistance. And they have something called a skills checkpoint that assists older Australians with upcycling education and training. So seniors are not forced into retirement, but rather can continue to contribute and earn. Now, this Australian-based blockchain developer, Immutable X, is very much like the example that Lily shared. And it's an NFT game that people can play to earn. With the games that they're playing, users can earn cards that can be traded for cryptocurrency, which can then be traded for real currency and other in-game items. But the idea is one that what I like about this is that it's not that you either spend time making a living or doing something recreational. It's sort of turned that on its head. It's about doing both at the same time. So it's kind of the ultimate in non-linearity.
Thank you, Fritz.
Over to you, Yuri.
Thank you. I got you there with this commercial, and we're already in the next trend. And this next trend is called sensory stimulation, which is exactly what the commercial coming from L'Oreal for the Victor and Ralph fragrance is supposed to do. So the team engaged acoustic experts to create a stimulating soundscape that is raising your body temperature while you're listening. And the idea is to evoke the fragrance effect without actually being able to smell it in a completely digital way. Our senses have been severely understimulated after several lockdown seasons and tele everything from remote working to online graduations, TikTok prompts, and even funerals in Animal Crossing. Especially Generation Z is now looking for real togetherness in new hangouts. Vice reported how airports are the new places to socialize for youth, as they combine the normal high street mix of food, shopping, and stimulation with the possibility to make perhaps new international connections or just do some people watching and some extra benefits as well, such as security for girls. There's no risk of harassment in an airport, and they have great public transport connections as well. But this trend is also about how digital will increasingly need to mirror real life vibes by adding multi-sensorial layers to create a more interesting experience. In Asia, metaverse life on Zepeto, for instance, is already quite common and expanding, as you can see on the mapping, while in Europe and the rest of the world, seeking multi-sensory stimulations is still nascent, except for the youngest generations, where it is already establishing. As you can see from both trends' scores, it is more strongly present among next gen, so the ones below the age of 40, as they are, of course, raised in a vibrant and very colorful Fortnite, TikTok, or Instagram-dominated media world.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Sometimes we laugh, sometimes we cry, but I guess you know now, baby.
By replicating Drake's music video of Laugh Now and Cry Later, which was entirely shot in Nike's Oregon headquarters, the brand announced its launch of Nike Land on Roblox. Through its metaverse setting, Nike shows how gameplay can inspire real-life physical activities as well. Roblox users, can compete in mini-games within Nike Land that they can also play offline, such as tag, the floor is lava, and dodgeball, while their mobile devices can be used to count your steps and real physical activities, and then transfer them into jumps and spectacular movements into the virtual Roblox game. But while media and consumer electronics have an obvious link with this trend, sensory stimulation can also help to make a better connection with next gen in every category. Dr. Utker opened 3 dessert bars targeting Gen Z in Los Angeles. The concept is focusing on pudding, but pudding positioned as edible art. It's a very Instagram-worthy indulgence that combines unusual flavors like coconut, pineapple, wild blueberry, or turmeric with superfood toppings such as edible flowers, strawberry dust, or toffee popcorn. We go back to Heidi, and Heidi, you had a look at the Australian results of this trend, right?
Thanks, Yuri. Yeah, it's a bit too early in the morning to be fantasizing about eating those yummy desserts. So I'll think about that for the rest of the day. If you look at the Australian data, as Yuri's mentioned, we follow and sit in the sort of lower left corner, which is that nascent quadrant, which means that this trend is not actually as strong in Australia. So it's a solid 10 percentage points less compared to the global average. So we know that Australia is typically a bit more of a follower in this tech space. We're a bit more geographically isolated, possibly lower investment to support this, and the Asian countries leading the way here. So other reasons for this in Australia might include that we have this great outdoor lifestyle, generally good weather, and we've actually, relative to the rest of the world, had fewer or less harsh lockdowns as a result of COVID. So we may be getting our stimulation fix elsewhere. That said, though, this trend is really strong with younger generations, so we're likely to see this expand. And even though it might be more nascent, there's some fantastic examples in Australia as well. And this is a great example called Fologram. And basically what it does is it uses augmented reality to bridge that gap between technology, design, and the human hand. And it overlays design plans over reality. And it's actually been used in the building of the Royal Hobart Hospital, which has just made construction much more efficient. Melbourne is also doing a really great job in tapping into this trend. Flinders Quarter have an augmented artwork as a self-guided AR tour, so you can go through the laneways and the arcades. And the AR technology is now enabling people to have this immersive experience and connect with artworks that come to life in this AI type of way. And you may also know of seeing the invisible art exhibition. It's about seeing the invisible, and it's held in the botanical gardens, where AR is enabling art, tech, and nature to come together as one. And another example in this space is the Jewish Museum in Sydney, which is incorporating leading edge 3D filming and AI to create a conversation that people can have with a virtual Holocaust survivor, and visitors can ask questions. So they've programmed 1,000 questions into responses and consumers can have a conversation that feels real and immersive.
Thank you very much, Heidi. So closely connected to the search for more sensory stimulation that we've just seen from the previous trend is the most prominent trend that we're seeing come through, considered rituals. And the trend is grounded in our drive for health and achievement. So with our hearts kind of increasingly set on finding a balanced life, that's something that we all talk about a lot in culture around the world. More than ever, people are proactively setting up rituals to manage their minds, their moods, their energy levels, with the ultimate purpose being to achieve our goals and to feel well. And the trend is a result of lots of long-term shifts that we've seen towards well-being-centric living. And in recent pandemic months, what we've seen is this become less centered on kind of self-optimization and that kind of more pressurized version of wellness, and instead setting habits that are kind of realistic and best support our internal rhythms and cycles. Globally, this is a trend that's really, really peaking. And as trends consultants working with kind of brands in categories, all different categories, we can really see that FMCG, beauty, skincare, food are really kind of owning this trend, and it's very much its heartland. Yet the holistic nature of considered rituals means that pretty much any sector can play here if they find a relevant way to ritualize daily habits and experiences. So for example, on the right, you can see the lower scoring sector of automotive and transport and travel, but actually, you know, driving and train travel rituals are a really prominent thing that people do all the time, and there's opportunities to do something interesting there. But what I think is important to say about this trend is that there's a real challenge in making your message and solution powerful and stand out from the crowd, because there's a lot of kind of overused terminology and similar ideas operating in this space. So to provide you with a bit of inspiration then, let's first take a look at the rapidly growing world of digital therapy. So having regular interactions with professional therapists is becoming really normalized in culture today, particularly for next gen, so millennial generations and younger. And Talkspace is a really successful example of this that was born out of the US. And they talk about having a therapist in your pocket, which enables you to, you know, schedule regular sessions with your therapist from the comfort of your own home. And in the future, we can really expect more of these solutions to come through, and for more people to integrate practices like this into their weekly, monthly, daily schedules. The key will be finding kind of solutions or delivering solutions that are enjoyable and easy to integrate. So that's kind of health. What's happening in the world of food and drink? Well, let's look specifically at tea, a category that has, you know, since it was born, been associated with rituals, but we're now really seeing it be supercharged with deeper meaning. So one specific example is Mood Tea, a tea brand that was created with Gen Z in mind and is all about kind of raising awareness of suicide prevention and mental health. And I think it's interesting that they put that at the very center in front of their brand, not the tea offer itself. But also when it comes to tea, they position their different products around ideas like self-kindness, slowness, or intimacy, which I think really goes a lot further than some of the more kind of generic terminologies that we see coming through, like, you know, mindfulness. It gives it that deeper level of meaning and also makes it more holistic. So I think really, really interesting one, lots of opportunity. Let's talk to Fritz and see how this is playing out in Australia.
Thanks, Lily. So consider rituals as a trend that's most certainly a product of the zeitgeist at the moment. And right now people are trying to make sense of their lives and mark moments in time, and especially during COVID when one day blends into the next. However, people are simultaneously leaning on the comforts and familiarity of customs and practices. And I see this as a trend that's a reflection of a more mindful woke culture where people are masters of their own destiny. But it's combined with a somewhat deterministic human need for certainty, I think. Gets kind of deep. As you can see here, Australians, food plays a strong role in considered rituals. But it's a trend that takes sort of your Tim Tam slam moments or your Kit Kat breaks kind of to the next level. It's one that is good for the body and indulgent for the mind. And a wonderful Australian example of this trend comes by way of Dreamy, which is a website with these beautifully produced soundscapes of cicada and spoken word from traditional Australian First Nations storytellers. And it's created to, you know, help people turn off their minds and drift off to sleep. And a part of the sort of e-mental health technology movement, Mindset Health have developed a mobile hypnotherapy app to assist customers with a variety of specific health conditions. It's everything for irritable bowel syndrome to depression, if you've got chronic pain, menopause. And they describe themselves, and I like the way they describe themselves, we're changing the definition of modern medicine to something more personal than just pills and prescription. More modern than ancient remedies, more grounded than just having our heads in the clouds. We're going to put the mind back into medicine. I think that beautifully articulates what lies at the heart of this considered rituals trend. And the blending of the creative and the conscious is also apparent in this podcast, Bibliotherapy with State Library of Victoria, which is designed to increase the well-being of listeners through self-reflection, and it's facilitated through selected poetry and novels. The podcast welcomes listeners to, quote, discover the healing power of stories and poems. And the head bibliotherapist, Dr. Susan McLean, says that she notes that the library entrances back in ancient Greece were marked with a signatory that said a healing space for the soul. And I think that she's, you know, really brought that around full circle. So at a time when people are craving human conversation and interaction, this podcast is meant to provide people with a space to pause and process emotions in a creative environment where the words of others can be leveraged as a springboard for better understanding of ourselves. And it provides social validation and a sense that we're not alone. And it's a non-traditional approach to reading as healing. So I'm just going to pass back over to Lily, is it?
Oh, it's to me.
Oh, sorry, Yuri.
That's no problem. Thank you, Fritz. If there's one thing, and you already talked about it, that the pandemic has taught us, it is that technology can bring people really together. And our ways of connecting are diversifying, both in the workplace, with remote working, of course, but also socially. And we're giving more priority to accommodating everyone's needs today. Just like the sensory stimulation trend, this inclusive connectivity trend is currently stronger present and expanding among next gens, so millennials and Generation Z around the world and in Asia, while still being nascent for other age groups in the West. And it's because it's a stressful time to be young, you know, experiencing lockdowns, social isolation, remote education, quarantines. So it's not a coincidence that most of the trends that we found that significantly were scoring higher among next gens are driven by this positive emotions human driver. Social media do give you a way to stay connected in these difficult times. But there are still some problems like safety online, for instance, e-bullying, and inclusivity is sometimes also a problem online. And brands can exactly play a role by creating more safe collaborative spaces, streaming or other initiatives for people to feel a stronger sense of belonging in the moment, even while physically being apart. Some examples. Blue Fever is backed by Serena Williams. We're still in tennis mode in Australia. And it's a virtual support community allowing young people to express themselves freely and safely and anonymously with a community of supportive, inclusive, and like-minded people. Emily Flores, on the next slide, when she was 15 years old, only 15 years old, decided to launch Cripple Media, giving space to young disabled people to write opinions and share experiences from their own perspectives. Cripple Media is totally self-funded and it's striving to train young disabled media professionals to lead conversations also in mainstream media. Generation Z are balancing online and offline communities. To them, it's not two separate worlds, but they can be layered, so both the physical and the digital world. And there are many online communities where strangers are sharing how long they're studying and what they're studying to monitor and motivate each other while they are trying to keep studying hard. This is an example you can see on the slide. James Charles has a daily live stream where he's studying 12 hours in a row, and he's reaching over 400,000 subscribers on YouTube with his stream. Acknowledging this accessible and honest two-way communication that both video gaming and avatars are offering, it's quite inclusive to young people, employers in South Korea are turning into recruiting fairs completely in the metaverse to engage millennial and Generation Z job hunters. This is an example of Lotte Engineering and Construction, which became the first company to hold such a virtual recruitment fair using GatherTown, with more than 400 job seekers taking part in the virtual event. And as you can see, the online event recreated some of the company's most famous building projects, including the World Tower. Gather, by the way, is a video chat platform that is specifically designed to make virtual interactions more human in metaverse layers where people can work, socialize, and learn. Just like in Minecraft for the gamers among you, you can create your own avatar, but you can also create your own private desk on the work floor with a Japanese pond full of koi fish, if that's something that you really like. Meanwhile, creating a more inclusive metaverse is high on the agenda of avatar creation companies like Real Engine or DNA Block. This Los Angeles-based company makes it easier for creators to build high-quality 3D avatars that reflect diversity, and they just received $1.2 million funds from a Japanese mobile internet and finance player called SoftBank. SoftBank is also already investing in the South Korean mobile metaverse app Zepeto that has 2 million active daily users in Asia, mainly consisting of a female and Generation Z user base. Now, while the link with media, entertainment, and consumer electronics is an obvious one, crypto and NFTs are addressing needs of previously uncovered age and target groups. In November 2021, NFT marketplace OpenSea reported over $10 billion total volume of collectible NFTs. Malia Abidi, who is a female artist, writer, and activist, created Women Rise, and also a unique collection of 10,000 NFTs featuring female activists, artists, scientists, programmers, and many more. And another female-led NFT collection is called Buzz Beauties. And it was featured, as you can see on the slide, on the NASDAQ billboards on International Girls' Day. They were sold out in 90 minutes while being auctioned to fund scholarships and mentoring programs for women in the financial sector. One to the bottom left corner of the slide will be kept displayed in front of the iconic Muriel Siebert boardroom, which honors the first woman to have a seat on the New York Stock Exchange among thousands of men. Heidi will now give you some local examples and insights from Australia.
Thanks, Yuri. So in line with the rest of the world, COVID has obviously really accelerated this trend, and I think we can expect to see it expand even more in Australia. And brands will now need to play more of a role in creating these collaborative spaces for people to come together. So be these virtual streaming or even face-to-face initiatives where people can feel the sense of belonging and connection. So we all know from the last few months how isolating COVID can make us feel. And inclusion and connection is really something that people are looking for. And particularly in Australia, this connection can be more challenging because we have a more geographically dispersed country. We're not on top of each other like Europe, and state lockdowns have really shown us this. So this is actually an example of something, an Australian company, which is doing awesome things and innovation in this space. And really it was founded to revolutionize the Internet of Things, and it offered low-cost connectivity. So what they did is they launched hundreds of tiny nanosatellites into low Earth orbit and to increase connectivity and data processing capabilities to more remote areas in Australia. So what they've done is they've increased the connectivity and cloud processing capabilities. And this spans all industries from agriculture to environmental research, transport services, ultimately making internet more accessible to those remote locations, which we know has been a challenge in Australia. So an example of where this has been used is we know that inadequate water supply is one of the biggest challenges facing agriculture in Australia. Millions of cattle are grazed in these remote areas where farmers can't always check in on their cattle every day, and they have low and unreliable rainfall. So they're forced to rely on patchy network coverage, or they have to spend large sums of money on high cost satellites. So Marriotta did this awesome thing where they designed a solution where they put modules in the water tanks, and there were sensors actually connected to these modules. And so this technology then enabled farmers to receive water level data to their mobile phones for the first time, which is absolutely critical to ensuring survival of cattle. Another cool example, which I really like, is OSME, and they are an online social media platform which is really designed around forming these more spiritual, meaningful connections through positivity. So they actually refer to themselves as the spiritual home of the internet. And you can connect with like-minded people around things like meditation, spiritual conversations, et cetera. And they've introduced a karma system, which essentially is trying to maintain a positive footprint on the internet. So users can be awarded these karma points if they post positive comments and interact with other people, and then they can actually use these karma points as real money at the end of the month. Another example of an Australian company is Rehab Management, and what they've done is they've developed these really innovative high-tech kind of solutions to help people who are undergoing workplace rehab. So they've got a Check-In Today app which allows people to check in to tailored support programs for each individual, and then there are extensions on this which allow them to sort of access support and undergo rehabilitation digitally 24/7. And access wellness coaches, et cetera, as they need them. And then the last example is not a digital example, but it's a great example that's really close to home in Australia. And what this really is it's a first of its kind initiative from the Black Dog Institute, and it's the Lived Experience Centre. And what this does is it allows the inclusion and connection with First Nations people, and it's designed to help manage mental health and suicide. So what this community is designed to do is acknowledge that lived experience is really different for all cultures, and it's unique and very culturally nuanced. And they're working with the community and working people to really help co-design and inform and deliver what is culturally appropriate, what is culturally safe to prevent suicide and help with mental health in Australia. And with that said, I'll hand back to Fritz, who will take us to the end of the session. Thank you.
Thanks, Hayley. To wrap up today, we just want to share a few examples of how clients have leveraged these trends. So the example on the left there is some work we did for Nestle locally around the extending life trend. And for this, we engaged Australians in a two-week online community to explore their current attitudes, thoughts, and behaviors around recycling. And we discovered huge gaps that still exist between all three, actually. People still don't have the information and the knowledge they need to recycle correctly. And even when they do, they don't fulfill their own expectations. The research in the middle was based on a trend around inclusivity. So Philips knew they needed to update and get a more granular understanding of their African American hair care market. And so we conducted some intensive social listening to better understand the target market's experiences, their tensions, their routines, their unmet needs. And we did further exploration of this in this space with our Loom Guides, our network of leading edge consumers. The project on the right, we worked with our 400,000 strong proprietary creator network, AICA, and asked them to develop a new hallmark logo for the European Federation of Glass Packaging, one that accurately reflects the current sustainability sentiment. But I'll leave you today with a fun example. We asked our ICA network to of creative consumers to create in the and innovate in the toy space. And we wanted them to do this in connection with the extending life trend. So you know how your local council cleanup, you go out there and you see a lot of kids' toys. This is about helping to solve that problem by extending the useful life of toys. So we had participants from over 20 different markets join this creative crowdsourcing contest, and it resulted in a bunch of great ideas, a few of which you can see here. I know it's a little bit small, but they are super detailed. And one of the winning ideas was this board game that grows with the child and moves from the physical offline world into the digital metaverse. So very extending life, very on trend. And look, we know that trends can be difficult to recognize unless you're sort of at a distance, and it's even harder to activate upon these things. But we hope we've given you a lens that you might need to more clearly see and chart that path ahead of you towards growth. And we want to be with you on the vanguard of that and on that journey. And some ways we might be able to help: our consumer trends and cultural insights and semiotic research, for example, can help with brand strategy and product positioning. Our insights communities can help you understand in detail how these trends are manifesting amongst your consumers. Our testing and validation research could help you understand the penetration and profile of various trends. And our creative crowdsourcing and asset development programs can help you innovate and activate on these trends. So thank you so much for joining us today. I think we're giving you back a couple of minutes of your time this morning. You could get another cuppa. But we're really happy to have been able to share these macro level societal trends with you. Do reach out and let us know how we can support. Thank you and have a great day.